you would turn your Bibles to Exodus chapter 34. I begin with a confession. It's so funny how Steve perked up. What? Yes, I have a confession. Sometimes I can be a bit dim. Some nods out there. There are times I'm not all that bright. Especially when it comes to the color of the carpet. But anyway, now there's multiple meanings there. It's probably all applicable to me. But Jesus said, "You're the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand. It gives light to all those who are in the house. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they can see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." Let me repeat. Sometimes I'm a bit dim. I'm not all that bright. Are you too? Jesus left it to us. You're it. You're the light. Shine. And so we're going to be looking back at Exodus 34 about a story of a man who literally shone. You could have taken him into a dark room and read a book. And so I'd like us to look at Moses. Moses was in the presence of God. He received the renewed covenant that was broken in short order. And God says, let's put two new tablets and we'll do it again. He saw a glimpse of God's glory. Again, if you want to hear more about that, listen to last week's message. And so we pick up after 40 days of Moses being in the presence of God, another 40 days. He had been there 40 days and then another 40 days. We pick up in Exodus chapter 24, verse 29. And here's the story. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the testimony in his hands, he was not aware that his face was radiant because he had spoken with the Lord. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, his face was radiant, and they were afraid to come near him. How would you feel if somebody walked into a room and their light not lit up, but lit out? You'd probably be fearful too. Was this person close to a reactor? Or some other thing? What's this? Kind of freaky and all that. And it was freaky to them. They're like, they've never seen anybody whose face glowed before. But Moses called him. So Aaron and all the leaders of the community came back to him. And he spoke to them. So Aaron and the rest of the leaders, they get as close as they kind of feel comfortable. And yes, this is Moses, and he's still the same. He's still glowing, though, and this is kind of scary. And so he speaks to them, and because it was okay couple additional things other than what I've already said. Moses shares these things with them. When Moses finished speaking to them, he put a veil over his face. But whenever he entered the Lord's presence to speak with him, he removed the veil until he came out. Now, this is a reference to a couple chapters earlier where there was before the tabernacle has been built. It's not built yet. So they had this other tent, and they call it the tent of meeting. And anybody was allowed to go in, but when Moses showed up, you know, God showed up in a manifest way. And so when Moses, from this point on, would go in and he would talk with God, he'd take the veil off. And guess what happened? Because he spent time with God, when he came out and told the Israelites what had been commanded, they saw that his face was radiant. It was glowing. And Moses would put the veil back over his face until he went to speak with the Lord. So this happened multiple times. As long as there was the tent of meeting before the tabernacle was built, Moses would go in and unveil and speak with God, and then he'd come out and he'd say what God said, but his face was glowing. And then when he was done, he'd cover it up again. Could you imagine? Could you imagine having your quiet time in the morning? And you pray with God, and God speaks to you through his word. And then your child wakes up and comes, and you're sitting there on the couch, and you're glowing. Mom, Daddy, glowing again. Anyway, you know, wouldn't that be, that's kind of unique. Wow, what a unique situation. Wow, wouldn't that be neat if we all glowed? We do. One side note, what a good pattern Moses is given. Before he met with people, he met with God. Before he would speak with people, he spoke with God. Oh, if we would follow that, hey, before I have that talk with that person, God, I need your words. Oh, what a great pattern. How many times do we just speak our mind? And people would hear. I think that happens every week. Oh, that we would spend time with God. So then when we spend time with people, there's a difference. They can hear the word. I'd like us to look, and I just have it up here on the screen, so you don't have to turn there, but this is where I'm going to be the remainder. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 3, starting at verse 7. He talks about what we just read. And so I'm going to read some, talk some, because what this does is it says, believe it or not, how awesome that story about Moses coming down and glowing, and when he goes into the tent and meets with God and comes out and he's glowing. As great as that is, according to Paul, we have something greater. Let's look at that. Because, you know, actually, there's not much application. Try to glow, you know. Now, the ministry that brought death, I'll explain what this is in just a minute. Now, the ministry that brought death, which was engraved in letters on stone, okay, what are we talking about? The old covenant, the Ten Commandments, the thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, okay? So, if the ministry that brought death, which was engraved in letters on stone, came with glory, what glory? So that the Israelites could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of its glory, baby as it was. So this is referring back to the story that when Moses came back down, he had the new set of Ten Commandments that had been etched in stone and all this, and there was glory and all that. He said, listen, if that ministry, which results in death, talk about it in just a little bit, was glorious. Verse 8, will not the ministry of the Spirit be even more glorious? Wow, Moses! And Paul saying, wow, us! If what Moses brought was a temporary covenant, the old covenant, and it was glorious, how much more this new covenant? Just a little words of explanation. Why is the old covenant? The old covenant depends how well we behave. You're judged by God by how good you are. Anybody want that? Because here's the sad thing. We don't obey. That leads to death. This goes back to the Romans 6, 7, 8 passage that we looked at in great length this spring. The new covenant. The first depends how well we obey. This depends how well Jesus obeyed. How well did Jesus obey? How many times did Jesus mess up? Perfect. Took on flesh, lived a life where there was no sin. In action, in inaction, in thought. And so the new covenant, it depends how well Jesus obeyed, and he did, and he offers life. You can't do it if it's based on how good you are. You're not good enough. But that's not what it's based on. If you would receive my son Jesus, it's how he was obedient. And so as we read through this passage, two more lines. The law gives rules. We can't keep them. The Spirit enables us to live for him. One, we're depending on ourselves to do it and we'll fail. The other is when we depend on the Spirit to do it. And he enables us. The old covenant, just from what we read, it's either of the law, the Old Testament's of the law, the new covenant is of the Spirit, the old covenant brought death, the new covenant brings freedom. It's many verses down, but this is what it brings to us. Let's continue reading in 2 Corinthians 3. Because it keeps going back. If this old ministry was then, how much more? So if the ministry that condemns men is glorious, it was, it came with glory. It's not that there was a problem with the law, the problem is thus. If the ministry that condemns men is glorious, how much more glorious is the ministry that brings righteousness? And again, the old covenant, it condemns. All it can do is say, here's the rules and you broke them. The new covenant brings us the righteousness of Christ. How much more glorious? new covenant brings freedom. The old covenant condemned. The new covenant brings righteousness. The old covenant is this fading glory. This new covenant is a lasting, and let me add the word, surpassing glory. The old is dimmer. The new is brighter. Therefore, since we have such hope, the hope that is not based on what we do or don't do, it's based on what Christ did for us. And we have hope. Since we have such a hope, we are very bold. We are not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face to keep the Israelites from gazing at it while the radiance was fading away. See, it wasn't just about, you know, people might have put sunglasses on when Moses was around because he was so bright. It was actually, he was in the presence of God, and he got this new burst of glory, and he came out shining. But he went out of the presence of God. The glory faded away. Talk a little bit about that, just a little bit. But the minds, their minds, the Israelites that saw Moses and said, oh, you're too bright. Their minds were made dull. For to this day, the same veil remains when the old covenant is read. Now, please, don't get that wrong. And somehow, that says, therefore, we don't go to the Old Testament. No, that's not what it's talking about. It's talking about not just when it's read, but it's when it's read and you don't see it in light of the new covenant. It has not been removed only because in Christ it is taken. This old veil that is between us and God, that is in the way because we can never attain the righteousness we need. Even to this day, when Moses is read, when it's only read in the context of, oh, I better do these, instead of Christ, thank you for doing this for me. A veil covers their heart. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. And the Lord is the Spirit. And when the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Now, a couple things. When we focus on what we do, I got to go to church. Here, got to give. Listen, thank you. I've got to do this. 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 Or else God's going to be mad at me. When you focus on what you do or we do, we will be dim. Where's your focus? On you. When we focus on Him, we will reflect Him. And we who with unveiled faces, see, it's not talking about, you know, we're unveiled, so, you know, it's that picture of Moses when he came into the presence of God, unveiled, seeing God for who He really is. We who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory are being transformed into His likeness with ever increasing glory. Literally, glory upon glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. See, we spend time with God. We have a clearer view than Moses had, who God is. Because we have a greater revelation of who God is through His Son Jesus. So if we have a greater revelation of who God is than Moses had, won't that glory be even greater? Chapter 4. For God said, let light shine out of darkness. May his light shine in our hearts to give us the light and the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. See, here's the thing. Moses, he would enter God's presence, and therefore he would glow. But then he would leave God's presence, because God's presence was only in this tent. And so as long as you go to the tent, all right, light up my life, God. And then you go out of your lid for a little while, and then it dimmed. Listen, that's sometimes how we view it. We come into church, and we're going to get our batteries charged, our light up, a little bit more, all that, and then we go out of my tent. See, we have something far greater. We don't have to go to a special place. We have the Spirit of God in us. So where is God? He's not a tent. He's not a building. For believers, he's in the heart. And so he's always with you. And if he's always with you, and you're acknowledging his presence, change the picture of being this light to being a treasure. We have this treasure in jars of clay. See, it's not about us. Look at me, I'm glowing. Because then folks know you again. It's look at Christ in me, not me. We have this treasure in jars of clay. Show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not in pain. Struck down, but not destroyed. In other words, no matter who or whatever this world does to you, the more we are squeezed, the more Jesus comes out. Sometimes God lets us go through it, so we let him. We're reminded that we're just jars of clay, and the treasure's him, and he is squeezed out. So here's a question. When life squeezes you, what comes out? Are we acknowledging God's presence with us all the time? It says we carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. Remember what Jesus said? He says, you've got to deny yourself. You've got to die to yourself. And that's when you're going to find life. It's when we're not living for ourselves, but living for him, that his life is revealed in our bodies. For we, who are alive, are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that this life may be revealed. His life may be revealed in our little lives. So instead of complaining, anybody here complain? Only me and Wanda, Rachel, Charles. We shine. Instead of worrying, we shine as peace. Instead of fighting back, getting even, we shine as love. Instead of fretting, do everything without complaint and argument, so that you may become blameless and pure children of God without fault in a crooked and depraved generation in which you shine like stars in the universe as you hold out the word of life. Listen, when we listen, He is always with us. So that glory is always available. The problem is we're walking our lives like He's not with us. And we're dependent on ourselves instead of Him. When we learn what that means, we start shining. And we're going to say, oh, I'm going to try not to complain. No. He'll just shine out not complaining. Listen, when we're doing those things that, you know, when we're, instead of complaining, instead of worrying, when we're doing the complaining and the worrying and the getting and all that other stuff, it's a sign that we are not acknowledging Him in our lives. See, when we spend time with God, we have a clearer view of who He is through Jesus. We have more glory to shine. I had that up there earlier. So again, I shine. I go to school. I shine. I'm around the neighbors. And I shine. I'm with my family. And I shine. And I spend time with Him. Jesus put it this way. Abide in me. This is after He said, I'm the vine, you're the branches. You know, cling. Hold on. Depend on me. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. Listen, if it's about you trying to push out the light to shine or the fruit to, for others, it's not going to happen. Focus on clinging to me. You'll shine. Fruit will come. I'm the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. In Russia. And if not, it's not like your light bulb will not plug in, going, I'm gonna shine. Because we'll do fake shine. It'll just be as good as we do. Now, if you're not shining, check to see if the power cord is plugged in. Am I connecting? Am I clinging to? For as long as we are depending on Him, and this is not just something you go to church and get and then walk away, it's something that continues with you every day. God, I'm not shining unless I have how I get unplugged. God, that when that came out of me, oh, I need to be plugged back into you. He's there, He's available. You don't have to come back in here. You don't have to go see somebody special. You just need to say, God, I need to spend some time. Listen, when we do, we will shine. And just like that verse will talk about, we're complaining or arguing, let this wicked generation see us shine. See the difference Christ makes. Not you trying to live like Christ, but Christ living through you. Listen, you have to have Christ in you to have Christ shine through you. And so do you have that relationship? It's not about going to church, and though it's a good thing, it's not about doing good things. It's good to do good things, but listen, it's when we realize that we don't have enough good to offer because we're sinners. And we come dependent on Him and saying, I need you, Jesus, to save me. But it doesn't stop there. It is every moment, not day, moment of our life. I must abide. I must cling. I must stay plugged in. And He is there available. The Spirit of God is in you. Be filled with the Spirit. And we will shine. In a dark, wicked world. Let's pray. Jesus, there are days and many moments that I am in. Because I'm relying on you and not on you, Jesus. God, would you show me? It is still, I partly don't get it, God. When I look at Moses and literally shown, and then I read your New Testament and says, there's something better. You should be shining more.